Hello and welcome to the first People's Republic of Brighton and Hove radio show on the television of this wonderful new year. Can we be the last to wish you a happy new year? Hello Madeline, how are you?
I'm good, how are
Excellent.
You?
Excellent, it's good to see you. First time we've co-presented actually.
Is it?
Gosh. Oh,
this is momentous, we're going to put this down in the history books.
Could be the start of something beautiful.
Oh.
Or not. Anyway, who have we got today on the show?
Today we are welcoming Kayla in and from Besco.
Oh.
And in the preparation for the show, I wasn't quite sure of your organisation, so I did a little bit of research, as I always do with our guests.
SWAT.
You know, I need extra brownie points wherever I can get them. But it'd be great for you to just give an overview of your organisation, how you're working with residents and businesses in Brighton and Hove.
And what does Besco stand for? It sounds like Tesco, but obviously it's the good.
No, it's a social enterprise. We don't
So what does it stand for?
Brighton and Hove Energy Services Cooperative.
Right.
And we do what our name is on the tin. We basically provide renewable energy and energy efficiency services to the local community. We go as far as Sussex.
Mm.
And our vision is to help with the transition from fossil fuels in our energy supply.
Right.
And to help inform people about bring more equality into the energy market, help them switch energy supplier, support them if they can't afford to heat their homes.
Okay.
All kinds of community-based services.
Does it involve like green energy production or is it just...
Yes.
Yeah.
It's
like solar panels.
So solar panels on your roof or air source heat pumps will do insulation, underfloor heating, anything to help you stay warmer for less money and reduce your carbon emissions.
Wonderful.
Oh, brilliant. So if we've got people out there watching today who are living in their homes and they've sort of, there always comes that time when you're reviewing your bills and wondering how to reduce them.
Yeah.
So what would they do? How would they get in contact with you? What's sort of the process there?
Well, they can call us. We have an office here right across from the pier. And the number is 01273-284-481.
Excellent.
And or they
do you have websites
they,
and
they
stuff?
Can
yeah.
Go to our website
yeah.
and contact us via info@besco.co.uk.
Right. So if they want to sort of go maybe greener or cheaper, is it specifically
yes.
green or is it just
yes,
a cheaper supply?
We're definitely green.
Good.
And sometimes
yeah.
that isn't the cheapest option, but we look at economics, so we won't recommend an option that's going to cost you more money. The objective is that you can save money by reducing your carbon emissions.
Is it government funded, this, or is it just an independent?
The work that we do on combating fuel poverty in the city is government funded.
Right.
It's either funded by the council or by the government.
Has that been affected by this government?
Yes, in part, but we've been really, really fortunate. We've been working with the council for about 5 years.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're their go-to partner for energy services.
Excellent.
And the objective is that we make sufficient profit so that we can deliver these services for free.
Brilliant.
Eventually.
Yeah, excellent.
That's always the dream.
Yeah, yeah.
So is there any sort of news in the energy world? Sort of what's sort of up and coming? What's on the horizon?
Yes, the biggest news in our industry is the fact that the feed-in tariff, which is a subsidy for microgeneration, so if you want solar panels on your roof and you want that subsidy, you need to have that system installed before the 31st of March.
Okay.
After that, the government is removing the subsidy, which is very short-sighted.
Surprise, surprise.
Yes. Yes, I won't go into all the promotion that they do. Actually, fossil fuels are subsidized about 8 times more than renewable energy in this country, and it's in a way that it's not so transparent.
Mm. Yeah.
So the renewable energy charge is right on your energy bill, whereas subsidies for fossil fuels are in the form of tax breaks or export guarantees, things that we don't see, but still impact the taxpayer.
Yeah.
And actually, renewable energy is the cheapest form of energy.
Makes sense,
it really should be pursued pretty aggressively by the government. So, yes, it's very short-sighted.
Maybe you should get some shareholders who are members of the government.
Yeah.
And then you might get something from them, yeah.
That would be absolutely amazing.
Yeah, that would be brilliant, yeah. As you say, so short-sighted as well. It's just. Anyway.
I think they might see it as a conflict of interest. I'm not sure, because Caroline Lucas is a big supporter of ours,
for example. Yeah, she's great, Caroline Lucas, yeah.
Yeah. They all are in their own ways.
Yeah.
But none of them are shareholders yet.
Yet. We could work on that.
Yeah, remain optimistic.
So that kind of brings us really nicely on to shareholders. And can anyone be a shareholder of Fesco?
Yes. Ideally, everyone in our community would be a shareholder, because we pay a 5% interest on your investment in the co-op. It's really a virtuous circle. So you invest in the co-op, we invest that money in the community, we help people save money on their energy bills, we lower our collective carbon emissions, and then we pay our investors a 5% return. It's kind of a no-brainer.
It makes sense in the biggest way, doesn't it?
Yeah.
There's no argument really to do it any other way, apart from profit for the shareholders.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not profit for anybody else or the environment.
No, and it's a great way of making a statement as well. You make a statement and say, I'm supporting this transition from fossil fuels in the energy supply.
Yeah.
Let's stop fracking in this country. Let's look at solutions, real solutions for the future, for the future of our children and grandchildren.
Yeah.
I guess it is such a complex issue, isn't it? And there's so many different components to it, and we sort of see the more public issues, you know, when we've got environmental issues that are being played out through David Attenborough's documentaries and things like that, and it becomes very sort of consumer friendly. And then we've got the issues that aren't as sexy. This world, the unsexy issues don't get the attention.
Yeah. But
if someone wanted to get involved and become a shareholder, what's the cost? Because it always sounds expensive to people, but what would be the minimum amount?
The minimum is £250.
Okay.
So that's not too bad. You can join in with a bunch of friends, say five friends of £50, and set up a consortium and invest together.
A building could sort of get together and become shareholders, couldn't they?
Yeah, absolutely.
Something like that,
Yeah, absolutely. We've got two terrific projects on the go at the moment. One is installing a heating system for Alistair Fleming Kitchen Works in Lewis, High Street. And it's a technologically advanced system that they're getting. It's like a heat storage system.
Oh, wow.
But it can take electricity from the sun.
Right.
And store that as well.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, it's the first of its kind. It's made in Scotland, so local. And so we're installing that there.
Yeah.
And also a heating system over at Homeworks in Hove.
Fantastic.
Well, it's just amazing that you're not sort of the leading force in producing power, because it just makes perfect sense.
Yes.
It's clean, it's in the future, and yet we're fracking. Why the hell are they fracking?
Because that's where the money is.
Well, exactly.
You know?
Why is,
And it's really important to divert that money to organisations like our social enterprise that will use it for good.
I think there's an element of education, isn't there?
Yeah,
there's
definitely,
sort of,
yes.
You know, I think for a lot of people that haven't really got the education around sort of new technology and new energy, you know, what does it mean? Does it mean if you have your home, I think do you surveys, is it?
Do energy surveys, and we'll look at how you can improve the performance of your home.
Right.
Excellent.
Because it all translates into money. The better your home performs in terms of saving heat, the more value it has, because the future owner or yourself in future years, you're always saving money.
Do you know what? I can say this hands down. Sitting in my sitting room, which is an old Victorian house, I had to go upstairs and get into bed because I was freezing because the cold air was just coming in. And I live in a rented property, so unfortunately I don't have any control over that. But I could feel the cold, but I could also see the money go out the window because I was trying to heat a room.
We work with private rental landlords.
Okay. So we would contact your landlord without mentioning you, of course, because we wouldn't want to put you in any kind of position.
Well, if it benefits, you know, in the long term, so.
Yeah, absolutely. And it will improve the value of their property, you know.
Wow.
So. Yeah, so we've only got a minute left, unfortunately. Any other big news you'd like to share? stuff we haven't mentioned, maybe.
In Brighton, we do a lot of fuel poverty work. There are people who go to bed at 5 o'clock because they can't afford to turn on their heating. Last year, we were able to reduce fuel poverty by 1% in Brighton and Hove compared to the rest of the nation, where it's increasing. Brighton has always been kind of a trendsetter and the kind of place where revolutionary new ideas come out.
That's brilliant to hear. Yes. Thanks a lot, Kayla. Coming again. That's well. It's great to talk to you. See you after the break. And welcome back. Messages, well, we always have messages, but they're working. Listen, it's great to be here. Thanks for staying with us. We have morphed into, well, no longer Jason and Madeleine, but they were good. They were good.
We'll be better.
We're always better. What can we say? I mean, you know, I love them dearly. Oh, and also welcome to the very first show, as Jason said. May I be the last person to wish you a happy new year instead?
May I be the last person to wish you a happy new year?
Brilliant. This I'm so glad
Jason.
Anyway, this half of the show, we've got with us Judy from Judy and the Doodle Cats. And, well, actually, I think because she looks stunning in the colours that she's
brought
with us.
She really does look amazing.
We should get her to introduce herself to you.
Hi.
Judy, hi. Introduce yourself.
Hi, please, I'm Judy.
Please.
Hello, I'm Judy.
Hi, Judy.
I'm very much out of my comfort zone right now. Hi, I'm Judy, Doodle Cat.
How can Judy we make Cat. You feel more comfortable?
Not be on TV. I like doing radio.
This is great. Well, remember, this is really radio for
TV.
It is.
It's radio
so
for TV.
You can see around
I'm
us.
Just ignoring
we've got the equipment and everything. And so no one can see you, which is why I can say safely on air, Judy is sporting a great, brilliant green wig and a bright red contact lenses.
All over it.
Yeah, brilliant. So why are you here, Judy? What brilliant news have you brought us?
More pants parties, basically. We're having our third party in your pants, birthday party, the Doodle Cats.
We've got to tell people parties are. Hi, Judy, what are pants parties?
Party in Your Pants is a topless, it's not a, it's the world's only topless feminist black light paint rave and body doodle. So what we do is we have an entire venue at the moment. We're at the Green Door Stall.
Great venue.
Growing to fill there. And they're very, very supportive as well.
That's really Trafalgar really Street, lovely. Yes. Mm-hmm. Green Door.
Yes, we're at the Green Door Stall. We take over the venue. We remove all lighting apart from black light. So there's no other ambient lighting. It's very, very flattering. Basically, then we throw paint at you. Everybody draws on each other. You can be as naked.
With consent.
With consent, yeah. Everything's done with consent. Yeah. You don't have to be in your pants. Pants are the minimum dress requirement. We wouldn't want you to go below that. But yeah, some people keep their clothes on, other people don't. Some people wear swimwear. It's become quite a big dress up, so people wear like outrageous UV outfits. And then we have an all-night cloakroom, so as you get hot or comfortable, you can take off items, go add them to your bag. You can end up, so some people, you know, most people the first time go, I'm not taking anything off. 15 minutes later, they're on the stage, and it's like...
liberating.
It is liberating. It's very friendly as well. It's grown slowly, and everybody who's there just feels like family. So even if you're new, somebody will know that you're new because they won't have seen you there before. Yeah. And they'll make the effort to kind of include you. So, yeah, we have quite a few people actually coming on their own, which is braver than I think I would be.
Yes, me too. Yeah. Me too.
I have to ask the question, how did you come up with this? I know we're going to have a club night.
Everyone,
I got there first.
You're good.
We're going to have a club club night. Yes. We're going to encourage people as much as they feel comfortable to take their clothes off, and we're going to throw paint at them.
Yeah.
I love it. How?
Loves it.
I don't want to ask why.
Why is a good question, to which I always just go, well, why not?
Well, why not? Exactly. But okay, maybe less why, but more how.
Okay, how, like most of the things I've done in my life, it started with embarrassing myself in a public situation and then trying to save the moment by doing something with it. So I was invited by a dear friend, Hannah, who used to run the Sidewinder, to do an art battle there. I'm a fine artist as well, but I do fine line illustration, black and white, very solitary, 20 hours at a time. I was invited to take part in a speed art battle with an audience of people drawing on a canvas that was, and I had these like big paint pens like these.
Fantastic.
Which are the opposite of a point. 0.01 fine line.
That's a great message.
So basically, I just embarrassed myself professionally by doing a really bad artwork, and then started drawing on my friend while we waited for the next round to happen. And by the end of the evening, the whole pub was topless and drawing on each other. And then I started getting invited back, and it became a monthly gig. I'd just go there and we'd do a pop-up.
Well, if they didn't invite you back for that, I don't know what they'd invite you back
for. I think it was pretty good business.
Yeah, I would invite you back for that, yeah, I think. So much fun, because one of the lines you got, someone in one of their reviews has said, it's messy adult play. And as adults, we don't play anywhere enough and nowhere near messily enough. This is in its third year, so you're doing something right. How many people?
We started in a tiny little venue. We were upstairs at the Joker.
Yeah.
To go down to the toilet, we had to go through the crowd of normal people in our pants and sort of like, it was all a bit weird. But we started with 100 people and we sold out from the first event. We sold out for a year. And there was a lot of demand to kind of make it a bit bigger, which we've been really careful about. It started as a passworded only event, so you had to be someone who knew someone who knew me. So we got the first 100 people were all known to somebody, and then they were able to invite people, and it's kind of grown. So everybody's sort of, we don't advertise anywhere, you know, it's on Facebook and through my sort of personal Facebook page. So we kind of keep it very close to home.
Yeah.
We're doing one in London next month, which is our first time in the big smoke, so that's a bit scarier. But we've done it a similar way. We've gotten our crowd here to nominate people to invite to the London one, and it's a passworded event.
Because I was going to ask you, how do you carry the safety over to a city that you don't know?
There's one tip which I would give to anybody who's trying to do anything that's sort of desexualized nudity of any sort that involves women.
Yeah.
You always have a problem with the potential of predatory males.
Yeah.
We mentioned the word feminism all the time, because it's like kryptonite to men who don't like respecting women's space. So we bang on about that. We make no apologies for it. We're feminists. We'll be feminist until there's universal equality for everybody, and that includes disabled feminists, trans women, you know, everybody, BAME feminists. So that is, it's brilliant. It's just like a real turn off to people who are coming for the wrong reason. And then we also have a zero tolerance. You know, even if somebody's making you feel creepy, we put the onus on men to make sure that they control their actions.
Yes.
They're aware of themselves. And it's the one night when women get to party without watching their backs, because we make the guys do that. Don't make someone uncomfortable. That's your responsibility. And we don't ask questions at that point. If someone comes to us and they feel uncomfortable, then we'll just ask the person.
So it's just the response, and you go naturally with, I feel uncomfortable, therefore.
And as men, we've discovered that that's not a very big ask, because we've got, you know, 200 odd people who come, and the guys who regularly come manage to do everything they're doing without making anyone feel uncomfortable. So it can be done.
You're here in Brighton and Hove, and Brighton and Hove is this lovely city, which is why we have the Republic.
Yeah.
With all the transsexual and gender questioning, gender redefinition, what kind of safety, what kind of changes occur that would separate it from the kind of binary of predatory male?
Is
there any, or am I?
I don't know. I mean, I think it's going to be an evolution thing, isn't it? I think we're all kind of learning where the new boundaries are. There are a lot of boundaries, and even me, as I'm nearly 50 years old, as a feminist, it was only in the last 4 or 5 years that I started realizing there was a whole bunch of stuff I was entitled to be really angry about I'd just been like, because I'm not confrontational. That's not my nature, you know. So how we do it, we work with brilliant venues, the Green Door Store. We had one issue once with a gender issue with a trans customer. We sent one email to the Green Door Store. They sent an email to Pagoda Security, who run their security. The entire staff at Pagoda and the Green Door Store went on Pagoda's bill to do gender awareness training as a result of that.
That's good. And
absolutely
they
kept, brilliant.
No argument, nobody questioned us. We just said this was our experience. They heard us, they believed us, and they took an action.
And you've not had an incident since?
Not had an incident since.
That's reassuring.
That's really reassuring, definitely.
Not rocket science, really.
Yeah. Definitely.
Next week we've got someone coming in from Stay Up Late, and they support people with learning difficulties and autism. And you mentioned people with disability.
Yeah.
How accessible is Party in Your Pants?
Well, we are have accessible for people in wheelchairs. That was another evolution that happened. We were in a venue where that was really difficult.
Yeah.
We used to have to carry people up and down the stairs.
Yeah, I know the joke.
So the Green Door is accessible.
Brilliant.
We did an event at the Volks before where we just got an accessible toilet and put it outside in the smoking area.
Okay.
We have free PA passes as well. I would, you know, if someone's got learning difficulties, it's a naked environment, so it would be up to the people who are helping them make those decisions to decide if it was safe. But yeah, we welcome everybody.
I'm really, really sorry.
It goes by so quickly. You've said that if people want to find out about Party in Your Pants, it's through your personal Facebook.
Yeah, well, Judy and the Doodle Cats is one of my.
We'll
pages.
Get a link up.
We'll get a link up because I'm sure that for following this. Lots of people will want to come and party with you. It sounds like
really
so much fun, and it just sounds like a really fun, inclusive atmosphere.
Very silly.
We've got to say the date as well.
Oh, yes, 18th of January is our third birthday.
Starting late, about half 11, isn't it?
Yes, start half 11.
Yeah. Now, as I understand, £15 on the door?
£15 on the door, £12 in advance.
Right,
yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And that includes all your paint, all your cloakroom, all your mess.
Brilliant, that's an absolute bargain. Thank you so much. It's been lovely speaking to you.
Well, tune in next week because we're going to have, as I said, Stay Up Late and the Big Bird Watch from St. Anne's Wells Garden.
See you then.